Hey folks, Joseph A. Sobora here. Yep, I'm wearing my Sandlot t-shirt that I just got from JCPenney. Yeah, it's looking very good. Very fine, because, you know, Sandlot's been one of my favorite movies, you know, growing up. You're killing me, Smalls! You play ball like a girl! Yeah, that's the entire cast right there. Yeah. I just really enjoy this movie a lot. I already did a review on it already 2 years ago, since I bought the Blu-ray. But now I'm going to get to an 80s classic that came out in 1983 that I really enjoy. It's called Christine. Another classic from our compelling director, John Carpenter, who gave us Halloween and his remake of The Thing, which I really enjoyed too. And it's based on a novel by Stephen King. Yep. A movie about a 1957 Plymouth Fury that's naturally red and white car. A classic car, to be presumed. That turns out to have an evil mind of its own as she goes around killing people. Yeah, this is one tough killing car that you had to experience for yourself. Yeah. But this was definitely another favorite of mine from Carpenter and Stephen King, because I really enjoy, you know, a lot of his work. You know, I was not a big fan of Village of the Damned remake, but you know, I mean, even he had his weakness, but that's okay, because I think he's one of the most awesome, compelling directors of all time. Not to mention, he's also the most awesome composer of all time, too, because he makes all these wonderful scores that he does in his movies, and even some of his non-movies alike, you know, like Halloween Free, for instance. Yeah, because he did that wonderful score that, even though he didn't direct the film, but he did produce and created it behind. But this was an excellent movie. It had everything that you were expecting for. It has a high school setting to it. It's, I guess you could say it's more of a teen horror flick than ever before, but it's more powerful. I mean, you get a nerdy guy who wants up becoming a total badass after that, once he has this car. And, you know, he's also friends with a popular jock. And they're both in love with the same girl, yeah, Lee. Yeah, all happened in one particular day, or weeks, perhaps, or even months, that this had to happen. See, this is the special edition 2004 release that came out, and they already released the 2012 Blu-ray release from Twilight Time. Yeah, because Twilight Time had a deal with Sony, or any other studios out there, even 20th Century Fox and MGM. So now basically what they do was that they just released all their Blu-rays as a limited edition, and they only priced them for $30. Yeah, $29.99. Yeah, but unfortunately they only released them for over 3,000 copies. Yeah, and only 3,000 copies, and that sucks. Because when this movie got released in 2012 on Blu-ray, it was sold out. They were selling this film like hotcakes. And I mean it. They really sold this movie to death. And all of a sudden, it was sold out. I was even planning on getting this on Blu-ray. I really did. Because it would have been awesome to own this wonderful film. I was so pissed off after that. Because later on, they did release a region-free Blu-ray release from Germany, and boy, just like the Twilight Time release, yeah, they both have, and this release, they both have a very good transfer. Although I think the region free must have a much better transfer. In fact, it's way better as it turned out, and it has all the extras from this release as well, and so on. So that was really awesome. It's just sad that, you know, that the Twilight Time is, you know, limited edition. However, they are going to re-release it later on And maybe this time it's not going to be a limited edition this time. Yeah, thank God. In fact, maybe they might fix some problems too. Otherwise, I think they'll just keep it the same as it was. Because, I mean, this movie deserves better. And that goes the same with all their horror films that they have, like Fright Night and The Night of the Living Dead remake. Yeah, they all deserve, you know, better Blu-rays than ever. Yeah, so, the sad part is you can't get them in retail, though. Yeah. So this is the only way you can get these films, you know, just the DVD counterparts. But, well, what can you do? Because Sony is just fucking lazy. That's what happens. Okay, well, let's get back to the film, because I really enjoy this movie a lot. It stars Keith Gordon, you know, who's been best known for his role in the movie Dressed to Kill, which is directed by Brian De Palma, sort of in the tradition of the movie Psycho, only it's done in an office building. Well, he went on to do another film that I really enjoy, such as The Legend of Billie Jean, a very underrated film that just finally got its Blu-ray release by Mills Creek, and of course, Back to School. Yeah. Who played the son of Ronnie Dangerfield character. Yeah, and I really enjoy that one too. Yeah, he's also now a director. Yeah, he's been directing several films ever since. He even directed the movie Mutter Night, which was based on the Kurt Van Guts novel that stars Nick Nolte. Yeah, that was a good one. Yeah, he went on to do a lot of stuff. That was really cool. I just wish he had continued to go on with his acting, but I guess, you know, he wanted to move on. Yeah, John Stockwell was also very good in the film as Dennis. Yeah. Yeah. Alexandra Paul, who went on to do the TV series Baywatch. She also went on to do the last time I saw her, though, she went on to do she also went on to do the film The Paperboy with that was from 1994, which also has William Cadd in the film. Yeah. It was so-so, but it wasn't that great. She also went on to do the last time I saw her, though, she went on to do a diving show called Stars in Danger: The High Dive, which actually aired on Fox. Unfortunately, it winds up becoming just a special only, because originally they were going to make it into a TV series until ABC decided to announce theirs, which was called Splash. Yeah, it's a reality show, by any chance, but yeah. I don't know, but I thought it's, I mean, yeah, okay, so maybe it's kind of silly at first, because I know it's based on all of the diving shows that they were coming up with outside of the U.S., yeah. It was mostly popular in Germany, mostly. Robert Prosky, you know, no longer with us, but he went on to do the film Mrs. Doubtfire. And he was also in the movie Thief. Yeah. Harvey Dean Stanton, yeah, another great actor, went on to do a lot of work, yeah, including Red Dawn, the original film from 1984. And Repo Man, very good actor. Christine Belford, Roberts Blossom, yep, who was very good in this film, by the way, because he later went on to do Home Alone, play the old man. Kelly Preston had a short role in the film as Roxanne. Yep, she's also the wife of actor John Travolta. With William Ostrander, Malcolm Danare, Stephen Tash, Stuart Charno, and David Spielberg. It's written by Bill Phillips, which is based on a novel by Stephen King, and it's directed by John Carpenter. The movie begins set in 1957 at an auto factory. Comes a red and white 1958 Plymouth Fury nicknamed Christine. Yeah. Which is on the assembly line, only created two accidents. Yeah, one was where a hood actually closed inside an inspector's hand, and the other one actually killed a factory worker who was smoking a cigar while, you know, trying out the car and listening to rock and roll, you know, just relaxing, you know, to his death. Yeah. It turns out that Christine must have had an evil mind of its own, because it turns out a lot of evil spirits have might have been possessing this car. So, yeah, flash forward to 1978, 21 years later. A nerdy teen by the name of Arnold Cunningham, you know, aka Arnie, who's played by Keith Gordon, who's basically hanging out with his only one friend, who's a popular jock named Dennis Gilder, who's played by John Stockwell. And during their first day of school, they're just basically hanging out, talking, doing a lot of stuff, until Arnie has been picked on by bullies at an auto shop class, which Buddy Wimpleton, who's played by William Ostrander, you know, basically just pulls out a knife and, you know, stealing his lunch and cutting his lunch bag filled with it and just messing him around, you know, until they all got in trouble. Yeah, while Dennis was already helping him, until the teacher finally came and showed him what he was doing. So, you know, how he showed him the knife and he told him he's going to be sent to the office. So during his first day, turned out to be a shitty one. You know, he winds up hanging out with Dennis in his car until he finally spotted Christine outside of an old junkyard, in which George LeBay, you know, who's played by Roberts Blossom, actually lives, which apparently the owner of the car turned out to be his brother named Roland LeBay, since he became very obsessed with that car and actually later died from carbon monoxide poisoning. He didn't tell about this until later on in the film. But as a result of this, he wanted to sell Christine for about $300, or $250 for short. So that way Arnie can finally pick out a car that he really wants and be able to fix her up in its original condition, since it was all banged up all this time. So now he can finally spend more time with it, you know. Yeah, repairing her with all these parts, you know, put together. Instead of becoming a shy, nerdy teen as he once was, he now becomes a total cocky badass in this film as his life starts to change, you know, along with Christine. So, yeah. Unfortunately, his parents couldn't let him keep the car because of that, since, you know, he's dealing with his college funds, you know, so to speak. And because they didn't even want that to happen. So as a result of this, you know, he decided to leave his car, Christine, inside Darnell's auto shop. So that way, you know, it could be safe. So he'll start repairing it over there and doing all that stuff. Well, anyway, also prior to this, Dennis and Arnie has a new girlfriend by the name of Lee Cabalt, who's played by Alexander Paul. Yeah, who Dennis basically wanted to ask her out, only to find out that she has a date. But soon on that one football game, he actually spotted Arnie with Lee, you know, along with his car, Christine, until all of a sudden, you know, he got tackled in and suffered a broken leg, not to mention a neck injury. Yeah, he winds up staying in the hospital for, you know, a couple weeks or possibly 2 months or so. Yeah, until Christmas arrives, so that way he can recover. Yeah, Arnie finally visited into the hospital, you know, just talking about his car. He's already hanging out with Lee at the drive-in theater. He also signed his cast, you know, by his name. So, during that night at the drive-in theater, you know, Lee is already having some different thoughts, since, you know, she's just already hanging out with Arnie, you know, just making love while watching a movie. He was already having some mixed feelings about the car that he was hanging out with, and he thought that it might be doing something completely evil, or so to speak. But that's what happened when she found out that once she was having a hamburger, suddenly she started choking, and the bright light sets to shoot up, already locking its doors, you know, not letting Arnie in. You know, he was already trying to save her out of there until one guy finally took her out of there and helped her, you know. You know, already pulling a hammock maneuver on her so she could be safe. Anyway, things didn't work out on their first date, and you know, she's already getting upset about this, so. And as a result of this, Arnie decided that after that last minute that happened, you know, Arnie wanted to make up for her because she didn't like the car. So all of a sudden, Buddy, along with his friends, you know, all the bullies, winds up destroying Christine inside Darnell's shop. And boy, and they really were destroying her completely. Until suddenly, Arnie finally came in along with Lee just to get the wallet out of the car. And so they can go out and, you know, and do something. Until suddenly, he found out that Christine was destroyed. He got so furious that, you know, he decided to break up with Lee. Although he did try one more time, and yeah, and then this had to happen. He was very devastated that he was determined to fix Christine again, as it's been wrecked over many fucking times. Yeah. But he also found out that the engine was now fully restored. And once he finally discovered it, Christine finally transforms itself. And that's in a very awkward way, because it was already, you know, transforming into its regular condition, so now it's not destroyed anymore. So anytime it destroys by moving everywhere by itself and everything, now it can even restore itself completely. So anybody who destroys it, will it'll just come back to life no matter what, while it's playing the rock and roll music. So Arnie decided to tell Christine, or what seems to be, I think, to actually seek out all the members of the gang who actually destroyed her by killing every single one of them at a time. So yeah, he even killed Moochie, the fat guy, cut him out in sizes. Yeah, and he even went on to go after Buddy along with his friend inside a local gas station. Yeah, and yeah, he winds up on fire after that. And then Christine all of a sudden winds up in flames. You know, just going to chase after Buddy until he finally got run over in flames. But then later on, a detective by the name of Rupert Rudy Jenkins, who's played by Harry Dean Stanton, has discovering Christine as well to find out if all the murders that's been going on. Yeah, which apparently, you know, he thought that, you know, Arnie might be murdering all of them. And with his car. But of course, Arnie was just basically saying that he wasn't with the car all this time. So he thought he was accused of murdering him. Which apparently he didn't, because he was already just, you know, just finding some new repairs and all his other parts so they can put them all together. In that sort of way. Because apparently they didn't show who was in that car because it was already been blocked. Yeah, because it already killed Darnell as well. Yeah, Will Darnell, who's the owner of the place, who's played by Robert Prosky, you know, who also started coming up with different lines of his own. He's very good in that movie, too. And yeah, he got killed. So on New Year's Eve, Dennis and Lee decided to make a conversation that the only way to stop the car, Christine, as well as saving Arnie from it, is to destroy the cars from hurting everybody. So Dennis decided to scratch the word Darnell's tonight, you know, into Christine's hood. And once they make it there, you know, with Lee, Dennis winds up bringing in a Caterpillar bulldozer while Lee heads to the office so she can shut the doors after Christine arrives. So trapping the car with Lee, Christine actually crashes into Darnell's office in an attempt to kill Lee. And all of a sudden, Arnie was thrown outside of Christine's windshield, and he was already being impaled on a shard of glass and was killed completely. Yeah. Long enough just to admire Christine one last time. So Christine decided to continue to attack Dennis and Lee with sustained damage and regenerating itself. Yeah, once again, we're, you know, transforming it back to its original use. And then killing it until it finally compacted into a cube. So then, you know, they finally survived and leave behind the remains of the car, which actually has a closing shot of the crushed cube in which the grill was already being moving in Bentley. Yeah. And the movie ends this way. Yeah. And I had to say, it was a fun horror film I have ever saw. And it worked because I really enjoy everything that went into it. It was also considered to be, you know, since the movie had its R rating, this movie also became one of the foulest films ever. Yeah, before the movie Scarface came out later on. Yeah, and that became even more of its record. Yeah, I mean, considering how violent the film was, and quite frankly, it was pretty mild for its time. So, other than just one graphic scene, you know, the rest was just basically just showing scenes of one of them getting run over or getting crushed, but some of them may be off screen as it turned out, so yeah. But it's very impressive the way this movie was shot, because you never thought you'd see horror films exactly like this. And just to think, this movie also inspired by another film that came out just before Christine, yeah, and since it's based on the novel, it was a film called The Car, which is another car that actually has its mind of its own, only to discover that no one was in the car, just going around driving across the country, you know, just running over people, yeah, any way they go, and they try to stop them, because it turned out that this car was as evil as it could be. Yeah, but that film was just basically a B-movie type of film, so. Yeah, I mean, it was made in the 70s, yeah, 1977 to be exact. It had James Brolin in it. So I wouldn't say it's the greatest movie ever made, but it was an interesting idea of a film to have a car, you know, that's that actually runs by itself. It's very scary. But Christine definitely made it up for it, and I really enjoy it even more. And I know, I do agree, it is scary too, because of having to see the car, you know, having a mind of its own. And it does a lot of crazy things to people, going around murdering them. It's scary. It is. Especially a classic car like the 1958 Plymouth Fury. I mean, think about that. This is probably the most beautiful, well-made looking cars of the 50s, and yet it winds up becoming a killer car. Yeah, go figure. But it worked, and I loved it. Sometimes it almost makes you wish you had a 1958 Plymouth Fury. Anyway, the cast of this film were excellent. And I love all the lines that they put into the film too. Especially this one famous line that I really enjoyed. Arnie actually said, and this was one of my favorite lines, was when he says, "Whoa, whoa, whoa. You better watch what you say about my car. She is real sensitive." Yeah. That had to be the most classic line I've ever heard in a movie like this. Not to mention all the other classic lines I hear in the film. Including the last line that Lee Cabot say. God, I hate rock and roll. Yeah. There are a lot of funny lines in this movie that I enjoy, but I guess you can kind of get the idea. Because it is very foul and all that. But I really enjoyed it. Let's face it, Keith Gordon did an awesome job playing Arnie. And this was the kind of role that nobody would expect it to play. I mean, in fact, originally I heard that Scott Baio was going to be cast to play that role. And who would have thought? Because then it would probably be like the movie Zap, which he had telekinesis powers, sort of in the tradition of Carrie, that sort of way. So that would have been similar, except it's a horror movie instead of a comedy. But no, Keith Gordon definitely wins by a mile. He was definitely the most underrated actor of all, and he was awesome. And he still is, too. Yeah, John Stockwell was also amazing as Dennis. Yeah, definitely the perfect jock for a movie. Yeah. Sort of in the Paul Walker type of situation. Yeah, I mean, think about that. Because, you know, Paul Walker did play a jock in Varsity Blues. But Alexandra Paul, my God, she was beautiful. And I have to admit, she was sexy too. But she was also very soft-spoken, you know, for a brunette actress that she got. And it's hard to believe that after that movie, she went on to do a lot of other films such as Dragnet. She was very good in Dragnet, by the way. And many others, too, that follow. Even the movie with Kevin Costner called American Flyers. It was basically a bicycle racing movie. And then she later went on to do Baywatch. And, of course, that film, The Paperboy. The 1994 film, that is, not the 2012 film. With Zac Efron. But, yeah, I had to admit, she was beautiful. And when I saw her last in Stars and Dangers, The High Dive, I gotta admit, she looked very gorgeous. Even at her age, you know, when she was, you know, preparing to dive. In spite of how much of a dangerous risk it was, she was beautiful. And yeah, and the rest of the cast was amazing. I mean, even Robert Prosky as Will Darnell, I mean, he was great. He comes up with all these funny lines that he does, you know, before his death, of course. And Harry Dean Stanton was amazing as a detective, and as well as Robert Blossom. Also excellent as, you know, the brother. Yeah, since he wanted to sell Christine for sure. And he was looking very old at the time. Long before he wants a plane. You know, the old man in Home Alone. Yeah, everybody was great in this movie. I really enjoyed it. I think it's definitely one of the finest Carpenter films of all time. It's definitely right up there with Halloween and The Thing as one of the scariest and creepiest, in that sort of way, horror films of all time. Yeah. And that's for sure. And also, to say the most, they even had two Plymouth models. One is named Belvedere and Savoy. So it's interesting that they actually did use two models that they used to build Christine once they filmed this movie. So it was interesting. This movie had an awesome audio commentary too, you know, with him and Keith Gordon. And it's very awesome to listen to because John Carpenter is very good at doing audio commentaries. In fact, he's the king of audio commentaries when it comes to DVDs and Blu-rays too. So he just really enjoyed it, you know, having to listen to him, you know, chatting around, talking about how they did this movie and how they brought it all together and how they're just making all these funny jokes and all that. Yeah, it rocks. I mean, no matter what he does, he definitely rules. Yeah. And also, it had a wonderful score, you know, by him as well, you know, with Alan Harwood. You know, he worked together. Not to mention that one awesome song from the 80s that's done by George Forgood. Yep, you know what I'm talking about. The song that became very popular to this day for it. And it's been playing on radios constantly. And not to mention, it's been played in many trailers and movies and TV shows and all that. And he also made a cameo appearance in the film too as well. At the end of the film. As a construction worker with the boombox. Yep, that was him. It's a song... Bad to the bone. That's right. That's the song, Bad to the Bone. And I love that song, too. That became one of my favorite songs of any movie, including Christine. Zach, I mean, let's face it. You just can't go wrong with that song once you watch this film. Yeah. Yeah, it must have been so awesome, too. And it has a lot of classic songs that they put in, yeah, all 50 songs, so it worked. Yeah. So I'll definitely check out Christine, because it's an awesome film. You never get tired of it, but you'll definitely be scared shitless. So, that's for sure. So anyway, I get Christine of a rousing killing of a film. 5 stars. I'm Joseph A. Sobora, and I'll see you later. Bye.